Thank you very much. Appreciate you tuning in. We are the VDM Project, a group organized to promote education and knowledge concerning vitreous and vitreous floaters. We view ourselves as representatives of the patient's plight, those who are suffering from this condition. And we try to approach the various obstacles and roadblocks to a better life for patients who are afflicted with vitreous floaters. The term vitreous floaters is actually diminutive, in my opinion. It's associated with nothing significant in too many people's minds. And therefore, we coined the phrase vision degrading myodysopsia to describe people who have vitreous floaters that are clinically significant, that impact their lives and afflict their vision significantly. The biggest problem, in my opinion, both on an individual and a societal level, is a lack of awareness of the severity that opacities in the vitreous and the floaters that they cause can have on people's lives. And so much of what we try to do and much of the work that we, the VDM Project, support relates to raising public and professional awareness of this condition. And one of the most effective ways would be in publications, and the other is in lectures. So as an update, as of March 20th, 2022, I can share with you that I've completed the correction of proofs for a chapter on vitreous in one of the most definitive textbooks of vitreoretinal ophthalmology. It's called Ryan's Retina. And Andrew Shackett is the editor-in-chief of this, the seventh edition of that textbook. And I've had the good fortune of authoring the vitreous chapter in that textbook since the fourth edition. The 2022 seventh edition features a lot of information concerning vision degrading myodysopsia. And to be able to include that along with all of the other diseases that are accepted as diseases raises the profile in the minds of any reader of that chapter as to the significance of this problem. So I see that as a major step forward. I've also completed writing the chapter for Adler's Physiology of the Eye, the vitreous chapter. That's more of a basic science oriented textbook. And in that chapter, there's a lot of information about the biochemistry and the physiology of vitreous, which is very important for a clinician and a scientist to understand how vitreous changes in order to cause the opacities that induce floaters in people's eyes and disturb their lives. There isn't much discussion in that chapter on treatment. Neither of these two textbooks are heavily treatment oriented, but I think that it lays the groundwork of understanding what's going on in vitreous, what changes from normal to cause these problems and result in vision degrading myodysopsia. Adler's Physiology of the Eye has been published since 1950, I believe, and it's in its 12th edition. I was actually the author of the vitreous chapter in the ninth edition, and I'm very pleased that 30 years later, I was asked to write the chapter in this edition. And in collaboration with Leila Chu, a medical student at UCLA, I think we wrote a very nice chapter bringing up to date the information on vitreous and including a section on vision degrading myodysopsia. The American Journal of Ophthalmology has returned a manuscript that we submitted on the topic of treatment of vitreous floaters and how to cure vision degrading myodysopsia. The reviews were favorable, and we're currently in the process of revising that manuscript to be resubmitted. And I anticipate that'll be done late March, early April. And based on the responses that we've received, I think it's been quite favorable. And this is, in contrast to the first two publications that I described, this is an article discussing treatment, specifically vitrectomy, in 180 patients, three different types of lens status, phakic patients, patients with monofocal intraocular lens, and patients with multifocal intraocular lens. And so, pending that publication, I don't really want to divulge the results, but the results are very good. Let's just put it at that. So that should be forthcoming. And there too is a way that will open doctors' minds to the fact that this is something that's serious and in the right circumstances should be treated, and share with them what the expectation will be if the treatment is undertaken to improve the vision and improve the lives of patients with vision-degrading myodysopsia. The fourth publication is actually already out, and that is a publication in Nature Nanotechnology on a revolutionary new approach to the treatment of vision-degrading myodysopsia. So that you know where you are in my thinking, the first two chapters were more about basic science and the physiology and the pathology of the vitreous. I then described the publication destined for the American Journal of Ophthalmology on treatment in different lens categories. Now I'm discussing a treatment that is completely novel. It's completely different from anything that's ever been done before. And it's the brainchild of scientists at the School of Pharmaceutical Sciences at the University of Ghent, where they are experts in nanomedicine and nanotechnology. And they have devised a nanoparticle that can adhere directly to the collagen in the opacities within the vitreous body that are causing vision-degrading myodysopsia. And specifically, the treatment modality that this is intended to address and improve upon is laser treatment or laser vitreolysis in patients who have opacities inducing floaters and vision degrading myodysopsia. There are three fundamental weaknesses to the laser approach. The first is that the most commonly used laser right now, which is YAG laser, doesn't really ablate the opacities. It breaks them down into smaller pieces. And in some cases, we don't know which, but in some cases, that seems to have some improvement, but it's not revolutionary. And the reason is that you take a few dozen particles and you break them down and you get several dozen particles. Sometimes that's better, but sometimes that's the same or indeed worse. So the actual laser energy is a problem. Secondly, the treatment with a YAG laser is very heavily dependent upon targeting the opacities that are causing the problem. Number one, we don't really know which opacities located where are the ones that are most injurious. But number two, it's not easy to target these little particles. And I suspect that the success of the treatment will depend, at least in part, on the individual's ability to target and treat specific locations. And then the third is that the energy level that's required is rather high. So these three weaknesses are inherent to the approach that is currently being done everywhere in the world. The nanoparticle approach addresses each of these three. Number one, it's been shown in studies so far that it can indeed completely ablate membranes. And that's been published in 2018 and 2019, and it's available in the literature. But the second weakness, that of targeting, is completely eliminated by this approach. And the reason is that the nanoparticles were designed in such a way to directly adhere to the collagen in the vitreous that is causing the opacities and the floaters and the vision-degrading myodysopsia. So there's no targeting involved. These are injected into the eye. They adhere to the offending structures. And it's no longer dependent on the skills of the treater, of the doctor, because the nanoparticles go directly to where they're supposed to go. Then using a low energy laser, the laser energy is preferentially absorbed by these particles. They're really brilliantly designed by the scientists at the University of Ghent. And that takes out another variable in the treatment modality, that being targeting the laser treatment, because you don't have to aim. You just generally expose the area with the laser, and the energy levels that are required have been shown to be 1,000 times less than the energy levels required during a YAG laser vitreolysis treatment. So the major weaknesses of the YAG laser treatment are addressed by this new technology. Where do we stand today? Well, the publication of the study in Nature Nanotechnology built upon the studies of the past. The initial two studies were in vitro, meaning they were in petri dishes and in experimental situations. This study was done in live rabbits, and it was shown to be safe, meaning it didn't injure the retina or the optic nerve. The treatment didn't injure the retina or the optic nerve, and somewhat effective. But the study wasn't designed to be an efficacy evaluation. It was designed to be a safety study. But that's a major milestone, to have done it in vivo and to have shown that it is safe. And I think it also has enough evidence to show that it's effective, but not definitively, meaning other studies need to be done. But then to get it accepted in a major journal of the Nature family of journals is a great achievement. And the scientists at the University of Ghent need to be congratulated for this achievement, because it's really an excellent milestone. There's a lot more work that needs to be done. There have to be follow-on studies, maybe in animals as well, but certainly in humans, studies have to be done. A phase one trial needs to be done to show safety in a definitive way in humans, both short, intermediate, and long-term safety. And then there have to be ways to evaluate efficacy, which we already have those, having developed them over the last 10 years. But there's a lot of work that needs to be done, and we are seeking partners in industry to continue this work. But I think the philosophy of this paradigm shift from how we've treated before to the use of nanoparticles is a very, very exciting prospect, and I look forward to continuing this work in the coming years. The other thing I wanted to share, and I'm being a little bit long-winded here, so I apologize, is that there are upcoming lectures. These topics will be presented at a meeting on April 2nd at UCLA. I'll be presenting a lecture on vitreous and vision-degrading myodysopsia. Then on April 25th, I'll be lecturing to the American Society of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. It's basically an organization of cataract surgeons. And I'll be sharing with them much of the information that's included in the manuscript that I described earlier to the American Journal of Ophthalmology, where different types of lens patients were analyzed from this perspective, and treatment was evaluated, basically telling them that if they have patients who are unhappy after cataract surgery, one of the reasons might be the vitreous, and they should look at the vitreous, not just through it. And they should consider doing something to the vitreous. In our case, we performed vitrectomy and showed that it was safe as well as effective. But this is going to be the first time that this group of individuals hears about vitreous. Usually nobody goes to a cataract meeting and talks about vitreous. So I'm excited about that opportunity to present at the American Society of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. And then the third lecture will be on May 21st to the American Ophthalmological Society, once again on the topic of vitreous and vision-degrading myodysopsia. So we are working diligently and aggressively on getting the word out, raising public awareness, and specifically raising professional awareness of the seriousness in some cases and the need for more work on the diagnostic side, as well as on the therapeutic side. And hopefully we'll be able to periodically share our results with you in the coming months and years. Thank you again for your attention, and for those of you who have supported us at the VMR Research Foundation, we greatly appreciate your support. Thank you.